Test 1, 2.
Testing. Yep.
Testing.
Hi, this is Mike Passiello with CSUN ATC TV and Broadcast Studio. I'm here with two friends and colleagues, Dax Castro and Chad Chelios from Chax. So, yep. Chax, it sounds like a dice game. Dax, tell me, what is Chax?
So, Chax Training Consulting was born out of, Chad and I speak at several different conferences, and we kind of feed off of each other. Every once in a while, we'll call each other and say, hey, you know, we'll talk about technical terms of accessibility or how we're gonna apply a solution or something, or what do you think of this topic? And one day I said, you know, this is really cool stuff. Somebody would probably want to listen to this conversation. We should start a podcast. He says, who's gonna listen to a podcast on accessibility? So here we are. It's been three, we're on season three. We have 80 episodes of our podcast, and Chax, Chad and Dax, the Chax Chat was born. And from there, the next evolution was joining forces in doing training and consulting on document accessibility. And, you know, Chax Training Consulting was born.
Awesome. Awesome. So what is it that you guys are actually doing, Chad?
Yeah, so, you know, Dax and I, our background, right? We both come from a graphics background. So documents have been our life. Right. I mean, for me, it's going, 30 plus years. Right. And so documents have always been my passion. And when accessibility entered my life, which was, 15 years ago, documents were just kind of like a natural medium, for me to focus on. And when I realized that PDF files could be made accessible, it was just a home run for me, and so. So Dax and I, we both have a print background, a document background, and so our focus has always been on document accessibility. I mean, there's a lot of people out there doing web accessibility, pretty saturated market, I think. But document accessibility is kind of an underserved market, we felt. And kind of combining the two of our knowledge, we joined forces, and now our focus is on document accessibility, on the training component of that, and also on the implementation of that in an organization as well.
Excellent. Dax, how does that work for you just in terms of clients? Are you offering companies training services? Are you providing? You're here at CSUN,
right,
so
absolutely.
You're doing workshops and things like that.
Yeah, so a lot of where clients are reaching out to us, we are at a lot of different conferences. We love CSUN. This is my fifth year now at CSUN, and we're presenting multiple days, and it's usually after a session or online, through LinkedIn, and they'll contact me and usually say, I'm struggling. We have no idea how we're gonna catch up on a backlog, or we've got this rush project, or I got staff that need to be trained, or someone just knocked on my door and said, hey, I need to understand how to do accessibility. And so they're reaching out for that solution, because one of the hardest things about document accessibility is there's no one place to go to just become an expert. It's a little bit of information here and there. And so a lot of people are self-taught, and they have little bits of wisdom and then maybe little bits of things that aren't quite correct. And so when they get stuck, they come to one of us. We have a PDF accessibility Facebook group on Facebook. We have about 3,200 members. And they find us on the group and say, hey, how do I solve this problem? And that's where Chad and I come in, start having those conversations, which usually leads to sitting down and a formal kind of training program, and how do we get you get you up to speed?
Yeah, excellent, very good. Training, what specifically are you training about? I mean, I know document and accessibility, but let's get a little bit deeper level of granularity here. What exactly are you training people about?
Well, fundamentally, our focus is on the PDF format, right? So as many of us know, the PDF format is the most widely distributed document format on the face of the earth. Right?
Except HTML. Officially, HTML is a document type. Tell me it's not. It is. Believe me. Take my word for it.
Well,
I'm an expert in this.
Well,
It's markup language. It's an electronic document. Hypertext markup
you're
language.
You're right. And you know what? As a print guy, when I think document, I think ink on paper. Right. So that's what you know.
Come out of the Stone Age and come back into the electronic age, buddy.
Yeah, but you're absolutely right, Mike. And I should start thinking about that a little bit differently too. But the PDF format, and again, I've been creating PDFs for 30 years, and you know, so the PDF format is probably the most widely generated type of document. Maybe that's a better way of phrasing it, maybe. But anyway, we all create PDF files. We're all making these files. But you know, when I realized that the PDF files that most of us create cannot be read by a large portion of the population, that really bothered me.
When you say population, just which population? Any population or?
No, that's a good question, Mike. So I guess what I'm referring to is, you know, the low vision population, the blind population, the population with, you know, cognitive impairments, potentially mobility impairments, you know, and forgive me if I'm excluding any of them. I'm doing this on the fly. But, you know, I guess what was a real eye-opener for me was when I learned that there were, you know, and this is part of my naivete, when I learned that not all people consume content the way I do, right? Not all people can look at a piece of paper or look at a document and interpret it the way that I do. And so when I learned about PDF accessibility and the fact that it was possible, I really gravitated to it. I'm kind of a techie guy to begin with, and so when I kind of started learning about the tag structure in a PDF file and the fact that by doing this it can be read by people using assistive technology and it just really was a huge eye opener for me, and I really just kind of gravitated towards it.
But Dax, I always thought, I mean, this is why Adobe exists, right? They created a document, electronic document format. I create a PDF that has the accessibility qualifiers built into it. So I'm gonna export it to an accessible version of PDF that I'm done. I'm one and done, right?
And that's what a lot of people think. In fact, most agencies that say, we require our documents to be accessible, then you say, okay, well, to what measure? They say, oh, you need to pass the Acrobat checker. Well, the Acrobat checker itself is not really checking to every standard, and it can only check things that are pass-fail conditions. Does an image have an image description? Maybe it does, maybe it doesn't. If it doesn't, it fails. If it has anything, it passes. And many times, it's auto-generated by Word, and a chart or a graph might say image of sunglasses. Right? And so it passes because the checker is not smart enough to know that it's not meaningful pertaining to what's there. So a lot of people don't understand that. Chad and I always say document accessibility is always a series of automated checks and manual review. You really have to understand the principles, and there are tools out there to make it easier and faster. But if you don't understand the underlying principles of what the tool is doing, when the tool doesn't work right or there's a special circumstance, you're at a loss because now you don't understand the underlying principle to making that accessible. So we teach how to make your source content, Word, InDesign, PowerPoint, Excel, videos, social media, all of those things. We teach you best practices on how to create that content with the best chance for it to become an accessible PDF. But there's almost always extra work at the end.
Yeah, exactly. So rule number one, just because you've created a PDF that you've exported from Word or from InDesign or one of the other authoring tools, is it's likely not accessible unless that document itself is just pure text.
Right.
Even then, my guess is, depending again on the structure of the text that's in there, you probably still have some reading issues, right? Reading flow and things like that would be accurate, Chad?
Oh, absolutely. And I mean, it's funny, as we do training, and we have these training classes, you know, we say that we're teaching you how to make an accessible PDF file out of whatever the program it is. But what I'm really gonna do is teach you how to use Word correctly, or InDesign correctly, or PowerPoint correctly. Because what most people do, Word document is a classic example. People say, new Word document, and they'll type, you know, this is my heading. And they'll highlight that, and they'll make it really big and make it look like a heading. But structurally, it's not, right? And not to get techie here, but you know, WCAG has a success criteria which is called info and relationships. And info and relationships simply says, tag things as what they are. If it's a heading, make sure it's a heading. If it's a figure, make sure it's a figure. And people notoriously violate that by not using Word correctly.
So this is another important aspect of what CHAX does today. I mean, we've talked a lot about PDF, but the fact of the matter is you're actually working with publishing software that produces electronic documents and produces electronic documents of different formats. Is that an accurate assessment?
I would say the biggest thing I tell people is it's garbage in, garbage out. If you and it's very hard because people get defensive. If you've been using Word for 30 years, you have a very specific way you use it. And when I come in and tell you, hey, you need to change what you're doing and you can't just make a manual bullet and structure it because, well, I don't know how to use the indent feature. The indent feature doesn't work the way I want it to. Well, probably not so much that as much as let me help you learn how to use the tool correctly. It's there. People are resistant to change. But what we find is that when people open their mind to what the end result will be, then it's much easier to make that change. The example would be a bulleted list. If I have a bulleted list and it's a list of names, maybe it's a roster of 100 names, if I made manual bullets for every one of those names and I'm listening to it as a person using assistive technology, all I'm gonna hear is bullet, first name, bullet, next name, and on down the line. But there's 100 names. I don't know when that list is gonna end. But if I used the list feature inside Word, assistive technology is now going to recognize and count out how many list items there are and tell me list 100 items. Now I'm prepared. Now I know I'm going into this list of 100 names. Maybe I'll read a few, maybe I'll do a search for a specific name, but now I have more information about what's actually on the page.
Excellent. So, okay, so you guys provide a suite of services, training services, as it relates to the production or the remediation training. Now, we'll just focus on that, of electronic documents. What if I'm a client or a customer and I'm beyond the training, but I've got some serious issues with my production system, you know, my electronic production system, you know, in the office? Can I call CHAX and say, hey, guys, can you actually help us come up with some remediation plan for these documents?
You talk about the workflow evaluation, Chad?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, you know, that is part of what we do, right? And so, you know, what we do is not a one-size-fits-all. That's one of the challenges that we always face. And so what we offer is, and we could do this, we've done this with a recent client remotely because they're in Rome, and they were not interested in flying us to Rome to
we couldn't
work.
I don't understand that.
Very frustrating. But anyway, so what we could do is we can literally or virtually come in, evaluate your current workflow, just take a look at how you're creating your documents. What is your process? And we can identify barriers there, right? You know, there sometimes it's just bad management, bad processes. But then, you know, we can evaluate that. We'll make a proposal to the client. We'll say, listen, we can help you. We can help, allow you to create documents more efficiently. What we also do, and when Dax and I went into business, we both said, we are not doing remediation, right? You know, Dax and I don't want to be sitting in a cave for 10 hours at a time making documents accessible, right? That's not exactly a fun thing for us. That being said, as we built our business and we started working with more and more clients, we realized that almost every time, right, people's exposure to document accessibility is usually a result of them having their website evaluated for accessibility. And as part of that process, of course, they go over all of the things that are wrong with their website, and they're like, oh, by the way, there's 700 documents on your website that are not accessible. And they're like, oh my gosh, right? You know, and so we often find our clients are under this mountain of backlogged files, and they think they need to tackle this backlog and make them all accessible. And that's where we also step in. So we have built a small remediation team that we can take offload those files from the client, have our remediation team make all those files accessible, and then we deliver them fully compliant files that they can then update on their website.
So I like your approach, because really first things first here is let's look at that workflow analysis. Let's figure out where those problems, you know, are occurring and plug those gaps, right? And fix those gaps. And then second, if above and beyond that, we've got to work on fixing those documents, remediating those documents, we will. But that, you use the word validation, Chad. So what tools are you guys using if Adobe Checker, if Acrobat Checker isn't good enough, if the accessibility checker built into Word is not good enough? What are you using? How are you doing it?
Well, what's interesting is we get this question a lot in our classes. People ask you, what's the one tool? What's that one thing? And my answer is, well, there's depends on the document, right? So we use, for when your workflow is primarily Word documents, there's a plugin for Word called Access Word. And that works really well for when you have a large group of people contributing content that all has to be accessible. You can't teach everyone in a 500, you know, person organization how to be an accessibility expert, but you can teach them some best practices of using Word, and then they can do the lion's share of the work to reduce that workload. So Access Word is one, Common Look Office is another. And then if you're at the end of this process where everybody's giving you PDFs, then there's programs like Common Look or Access PDF. Now, Common Look is great for when you have lots of complex issues you have to fit, structure you have to tag in a document. Maybe it's an untagged document or a poorly tagged document. It works really well. Access PDF, if I've got a document that's really table heavy, I can do all of those table accessibility issues, fix all of them really quickly. I mean, literally in seconds compared to hours. Honestly, we became aware of the Access PDF tool just a couple years ago, and I almost cried, literally, thinking about all of the hundreds of hours I spent manually remediating tables when all I had to do with this tool was click a few places and I was done. It really is the, and then there are a lot of free tools. Callus, PDF Go HTML, Made to Tag is another one. If you're using InDesign and you're trying to make your documents compliant, it's a program that sits inside InDesign. It allows you to export stuff correctly. So there's a wide variety of programs to really help you in every step of the way.
Excellent. Very good. So that's good. That gives our audience a little something to think about, taking notes, and they'll have this recording here to fall back on. Now, let's go back to the business side of this, the business of accessibility. So why do clients come to you? Give me 2-3 reasons. Why do they come to you?
Well,
I'm not talking about your expertise level. I know that part of it.
Yeah, sure.
But why do they actually come?
Why do clients come to CHACS for help, is what you're saying. Yeah. We find our clients fall under a couple of different categories, right? I mean, we have some clients who, by their own accord or however, they discover accessibility and they see the value and the importance, and they just want to be... They want to do the right thing, right? They're probably fewer and further between, you know what I mean?
Yep.
We don't get them a ton. More often than not, clients are worried about the lawsuit, right? You know, clients are, it's more out of necessity, if I'm being honest, than it is about doing the right thing, you know? So, for example, I just remediated a document for BMW, right? And they said, we want to make our catalog accessible. Now, there are certain people out there who would be like, why is a blind person buying a car, you know? Well, we don't get to choose that, first of all, right? That's a very ableist statement to say. But the reality is, certainly a blind person may enjoy riding in a BMW car, riding in a luxury automobile. But the point is that BMW came to us and they're like, listen, we need to make this document accessible because we want to avoid any potential lawsuits because of us distributing a public-facing document that potentially could not be read by a certain group of the population.
So that's good in their part because they're doing something preemptive before the fear kicks in and they really are dealing with a lawsuit, so to speak. They're getting ahead of the game. Dax, What are some of the challenges for the personnel, the folks there that are making the phone calls to you guys? What are they dealing with on a personal level?
Well, I think one of the things that really, going back to your other question, I think one of the things that really separates Chad and I from other organizations is our focus on the user experience. That we really are about the user experience. I love the rules. I literally am probably one of only a few people in the world who have read the entire PDF UA standard to understand the nuances, and I look at all the tables and I make notes and all the standards to understand the technical end of it. But I am so passionate about making sure that the end user experience is, and we both are, making sure that end user experience is a good user experience, that I'm really designing things with accessibility in mind. And I think what our clients are often coming to us for is not how do I check the box, but how do I do the right, how do I make this a good user experience? And that requires, I think, a different level of understanding beyond the actual code, the actual standard. And I really feel there's so many times where we had an instance where a teacher wanted to make, they were reading Shakespeare, and they said, well, we've got the original version and the New Age version. And how do I get this line for line comparison so that we can read it in a story format, but then skip over and say, okay, well, what is the new version of this say? And so Chad and I noodled over it and tried to come up with a solution. And what we ended up with is that if you presented it in a table format, then you could see line for line the English versus the original versus the New Age. And somebody said, well, I want to know what line number I'm on. Great. Add another column with the line number in it. And now, programmatically, they can go right to line 45, know what it said in the old version, know what it says in the new version. And it's that kind of solutions consulting that we do for people that I really think sets us apart.
Excellent.
I was just going to say, like, you know, one of the aspects of content consumption that we forget about, and our friend Lucy Greco kind of reminded us about this at another conference, is that a lot of times a blind or low vision user might be reading a document and referencing that document with a sighted user, mm-hmm. right? And you know, there's a thing we do in document accessibility where sometimes we'll artifact figures because we think they have no value. And Lucy reminded us that, but if I'm looking at a document with a sighted user and they say, oh, it's the paragraph below the figure, and I've artifacted the figure, they now lost that landmark, right? And so similar to what Dax was saying about those line numbers, I mean, those line numbers become the reference by which you can communicate. So you can say, go to line 945, okay, now we're both in the same spot and we can evaluate that content together.
Yeah, that is excellent. And I really do appreciate your point about user experience, because in the end, if users can't render that document, if they can't read it, and whatever AT that they're using, what good is it, right?
Well, you know, that the we always tell people, no one's going to sue you because you didn't pass 1.3.1 or 4.2.5. They're going to sue you because there's a significant barrier in your document. I opened the document. I couldn't understand the information I was supposed to get from it in a timely manner that helped me make that. Cost me a loss, a decision, or an opportunity, and that's what they're going to sue you for. So we need to be careful about trying it is about the standard, but it's really about that user experience, because the end user, I would venture to say that 95% or more of blind and low vision users don't understand every single rule of WCAG. They just know they can or can't get to something.
You don't have to be blind or low vision not to understand WCAG.
I agree. I agree there.
I was there when we first created the first document. I'm still trying to understand it, right? 35 years later. So here we are at, frankly speaking, the world's largest technology conference for people with disabilities, now in Anaheim, at CSUN. What are you guys doing here?
I am living the dream. I told Chad, as we walked into the hotel, it literally was like coming home. So this is my fifth year being here, and I came here first as just an attendee, and I've been speaking the past 3 years. And I really feel like there is no other conference in the world that I live in where I can firsthand interact with the people that I am serving. When I make documents accessible, when I'm in my room, in my cubicle, in my office, making these things, doing all this work, I'm so separated from the end user, and coming to CSUN and being able to be in an environment where I see people with all abilities thriving and moving and getting lunch and going to conferences and asking great questions and participating in a very meaningful way, it really recharges me to be able to go home and go, I love what I do because I can see the impact.
Yeah. So you guys had pre-conference workshops yep. here. Is that correct?
Yeah. And document testing with NVDA. We had about 14 people in there, and we had actually 3 blind users in our class. It was really great because their experience and understanding of what that user experience is like really helped build the class.
Awesome. And how about sessions? Have you done any, or are you doing any general sessions?
Yeah, I had one yesterday. I did. What is it called?
Accessible forms?
Yeah, approach to accessible PDF forms. Dax had one today, which was...
Anatomy of an accessible PDF.
Good thing you have him here with you.
What's that?
Good thing you have him here with you.
Oh, my God.
You don't know what you're teaching.
He's on the left side of my brain, you know? And then tomorrow, we each have a session. I'm doing addressing complex table headers in a PDF, and Dax is doing...
Designing with accessibility in mind.
See? Yeah. I'll tell you.
And I will tell you, the handouts that we provided that go along with our class are really, we don't give them out very often. Normally, we give one handout away with our classes, but I packed 6 handouts in my last class, and I think I have another 4 in this other one coming up. So wow. It's good stuff.
Good. Good for you guys. Well, we've reached a point now here where maybe we could take a couple questions,
yeah,
from,
questions.
From the audience. Let's see, we have microphones out there. Dave, hold on just a second, while my mic man, Dave, sounds like he's a gas station guy. We have a question right down here in front, the woman down here. And if you could just introduce yourself, say your name and where you're from, and then we'll ask you a question.
Hi, thank you. I'm Katie, I'm from Jacobs Engineering. And my question would be for the people that are coming to you, what do we need to ask our bosses, our executives, to get the support for training and the technology to make our documents to learn about accessibility?
Well, I think that definitely asking for training is always the hardest thing, because usually our bosses are separated from the struggles that we have. But what we have a session that we do called the True Cost of Training. And what it is, we talk about the idea that you're gonna spend a significant portion of your time searching for how to fix certain things. And that time adds up over the years. So maybe training might cost you $500 or $600 or $1,000 to get the training you need, but if you have to do it on your own, you might spend $2,000 worth of your own billable time that you could be working on other things, just trying to learn the thing that is you're trying to do. There's no accessibility button that's just gonna magically make it all happen. And there's no one YouTube video you can go look at, although our YouTube channel has quite a few. Being able to understand that trade-off of learning on your own versus getting the right training off the bat, I think is really, really important.
Do you want to talk about that form that we created that we're working on?
Are we
allowed to talk about that?
We could probably talk about that. So we're working on a webinar right now called The True Cost of Training, and we have a web form where users can actually go and fill out, how many hours of time am I doing remediation? What percentage of time am I learning new things on my own? And what does my billable hours kind of cost? And what does that mean for my company? And then the form will actually do all the math and show you that you're potentially spending $10,000 over the next 2 years to try to become an accessibility expert, because we know that it takes about 1.5 to 2 years to become an expert or to be proficient in document accessibility. And so do you want to spend $10,000 over those years, or how about you just spend the $1,200 to hire us and have come out and do the accessibility training you need?
Okay, thank you. Boy, we got a lot of questions, that's great. Go ahead, please.
My name is Sloan Miller, I'm with Tamman, also based in the Philadelphia region as Chad is. I have a question about balancing design aesthetic and accessibility needs. I know you both are background in design, and the reason we still use PDFs is because you can make them really design forward. But how do you balance the need for accessibility with the pushing design forward?
Yeah, I mean, we actually build a fair amount of that into our training, because that's a really common misconception. You know, people are like, oh my God, I can't use all these colors now. My designs are gonna look like, you know, like junk or like, you know, like primitive. And that's not really the case. You know, we've got a couple of, we have a script that we developed and it basically, you can run this script and it'll build out all of the color combinations that are possible in your document based on the swatches that you've built. I mean, some of it is just education, right? You know, I mean, there's this trend right now, a lot of you have probably seen it, where designers love to make body text light gray. Has anybody seen that aesthetic? Yeah. And, you know, Dax and I, we're always sending each other screenshots of stuff. And, you know, when we encounter that, we're like, man, you're really like not doing, you know, doing anybody a service but by doing that. So, and that's just one quick example. But yeah, we do build that into our training. And there are millions of colors that you can use. You just have to kind of change your approach. And you can still create beautiful designs. You just have to keep accessibility in mind.
You know, we have this thing called the 70-20 rule that you can get, if you, doing accessibility along the way, really takes about an extra 20% of time, right? If you bake in accessibility into your designs, make the right color choices, think about alt text, make color differentiations, those things are not very hard to do as you go. But if you do accessibility at the end, it can take 70% of the time it took you to actually make the document to go back and fix all of those things at the end. So whenever you can, we find the people who ask that question, how do I balance it? It's because they're almost always doing accessibility at the end versus doing a little bit along the way.
Okay, thanks very much for today. Please, this young woman here.
Hello, Whitney Bacon with the Iowa Braille School. You guys mentioned that, I guess a big problem is approaching people who are resistant to change.
Yep.
So do you have a good suggestion of how do you approach people who are very resistant to change?
I found a bat is helpful.
Come on now.
Or a lawyer.
I'm gonna move over this way a little bit from this side.
We actually do a lot of presentations to like C-suite executives at companies, right? And we don't take the approach of beware of the lawsuit, right? That is not at all the approach that we take. What we try to explain to people is how important it is to make sure that I don't know the numbers, but like the purchasing power of the blind community is huge, right? You know, and so let's be real. I mean, a lot of times those people who are you know, concerned about that, they're looking at the bottom line, right? They're like, oh, well, this is gonna cost me money. If I make these documents accessible, it's gonna cost me money, right? But if you look at it in kind of like the reverse and you say, well, listen, by doing this, I'm gonna reach a bigger audience, right? There's value in that, right? And you know, people say, well, like, accessibility is hard. And I don't fully agree with that. You know, with education, with knowledge, and with building it in as you go, it becomes a very natural part of the process, you know?
Well, I think that it can be very overwhelming for someone who's doing things a certain way, right? You're in InDesign, you only build it a certain way, you have no idea what the articles panel is, you're not using styles, you don't have those best practices. What I find is that when you can just simply show them, not related to accessibility, let me help you build your document smarter, so that when somebody comes back and says, hey, I'd like to change that font size or that color, or I really don't want this thing that is existent in the entire document this way, you can just change it once and the entire document changes. The good part about that is it also makes it accessible. So when we can take those small lessons and teach them the small things, then gradual change over time becomes easier than, hey, everything you've been doing before is wrong, now you have to do it all this way.
It's funny, a large part of the InDesign accessibility training that I do, leads to more InDesign training. Because again, and this is, I mean no disrespect to anybody, but people think they know a product until you show them that they don't.
Right.
Right. And that really applies to Word. Word is a key example, right? You know, people have been using Word for 30 years. And I walk in and introduce them to styles. And they're like, what is this black magic that you're showing me, right? But like when you show them, hey, if you create a style for your heading and your boss comes to you and says, I don't like the color of that heading, can you make it purple? And you can make every heading in your document purple in 5 seconds, that's efficiency. That is really a fact, and it really resonates with them because they're like, oh my gosh, this makes my life easier.
Well, we were on stage at Creative Pro Week. He and I were presenting a topic, and he goes, yeah, you just go over here and you just do balance ragged headings. And I went, what? I've been using InDesign since it was all this PageMaker. So I've definitely been using the product for quite a while, and I just wasn't aware of that feature in the document.
Excellent. Thank you. Hopefully that was helpful. We probably have time for one more question. Can we take your question, please?
Hi, my name is Karen, and I'm here from a little college up north in California, Community College, and I am new to the alt media world, and so I'm learning about the all of this PDF remediation and stuff. But what about our website that I'm not in control of? How do I get to my supervisors and explain to them what needs to happen, and then who would you recommend I send them to?
Well, I mean,
I know a guy, right? I know a guy. We definitely could help you figure that out.
Yeah, we can certainly talk after our session. I mean, there's a lot of companies out there, and if I'm being honest, I mean, most of those companies will run a scan on your website, probably free of charge, just to show you how many problems there are, right?
They already did that for me today.
Right, exactly.
Yeah, we're not doing very well.
And so, if you present that report, I mean, the proof is in the pudding, you know. Give the report to your boss or whomever, say, hey, listen, we're not doing too well, you know, and they, of course, can certainly help you fix those problems as well.
The other approach that I find is really, really poignant is when you can just show them the barriers. If you know, we do a Zoom or a webinar or a Teams or, you know, a virtual meeting where we review the website with you and literally walk through the barriers in the site. Because you can hand a supervisor a report that shows 15 or 20 different failure points, but they're not experts in web accessibility. But if you go on the website and you say, look, I want to try to get to this menu, and you're like, the cursor just skips over that part and goes around the other way. That's so very impactful for a supervisor to be able to look and go, well, why does it do that? Well, it's the way you built the website. Well, that's dumb. No duh. Let's fix that, right? And then so that it becomes much easier to kind of get that buy-in to then fix it. And we can help you create a plan to make that happen. So,
thank you. Thank you both. So the company is Chax.
Right.
Dax Castro. Chad Chelius, website. What's your website address?
Accessibilityunraveled.com.
Accessibilityunraveled.com. Very good. And do you have a booth here?
We do. Our booth is 423. And, of course, you can go find our podcast, Chax Chat, on any podcast streaming service. Just look up Chax, and you'll find us. And, you know, we'd love to schedule some time.
Very good. Thank you. So I'm Mike Passiello with CSUN ATC TV Web Studio. Thank you, Chad. Chad, thank you, Dax.
Thank you.
Thanks, Mike.
Take care and have a good conference.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is JJ Meadow. I am the owner and co-founder of AT Guys. We are an access technology company providing tech services, training, and consulting, as well as affordable access technology products. Really with a focus on what's next, the future, and really innovative and awesome ideas and products. Over the past several years, I have hosted a podcast co-hosted called the Blind Bargains Cast, and that's allowed me to see many interesting and innovative technologies and new fields, including indoor navigation. When we talk about indoor navigation, there is one name that comes up right away as a person synonymous in that field. That's Mike May of Good Maps. Mike is with me today. Good afternoon, Mike.
Yeah, thanks.
Yes, give him a hand. Absolutely.
Afternoon, everybody, and JJ, and it's great to hear Alex out there on Good Maps giving some people directions here, which is how I found this room. I had no idea that I had to circle all the way back around these hallways to find Platinum 9 and 10. I'm chief evangelist at Good Maps, something that actually evolved almost exactly 4 years ago when JJ and I met up at a symposium at the American Printing House in a museum downtown, and we were hearing about indoor navigation from all sorts of people, everybody who was really hoping this would be the next technology. We can get you to the building, now what happens when you get in the building? And we met, talked with those people, and heard there about Good Maps launching, and Jose Gastambide was the CEO, and I said, well, I'm happily employed where I am, but if there's ever a spot where you need somebody who knows a little bit about navigation, give me a call. And he said, we'll find a job for you. So it all started exactly 4 years ago at that convention. And I've been working on accessible navigation since the 90s, and it's really evolved in so many different ways. And indoor navigation, believe it or not, started in the mid-90s. And there's always been this elusive challenge to get the technology right and then to make it economically viable. And I think we've finally turned that corner and gotten to a point where we can really see it implemented in a widespread fashion.
Yeah, we've really come a long way since then, but let's talk about how things got started. You were working, of course, with outdoor navigation and then as transitioning to indoor. Talk a little bit about the background and development of indoor navigation. There's a lot of different situations and issues that we deal with indoor.
Yeah, indoors, you don't have the two critical elements of a mapping system. One is positioning and the other is maps. So how do you position indoors where GPS is not available, or as they like to call it, GPS denied? And it can leak into buildings a little bit. You'll see more and more. You can go into an airport and GPS comes in through the skylights and the windows, and your accuracy isn't 10 feet, it might be 50 feet, but it still kind of works. But in the bowels of a convention center, or even probably in this room, you wouldn't pick up much GPS. On the iPhone, by the way, or the Android phone, we talk about GPS, but it's really a combination of sensors that are picking up positions, a little bit of Wi-Fi, and the cell phone network, and GPS. So it's not all about just the satellites. So that's what we've had to work with for all these years. And we tried different techniques for positioning indoors. We had fluorescent lights. We tried Wi-Fi fingerprinting. And dead reckoning was really the thing that was the most interesting, because it means that if you know your starting point, you can navigate from that spot to everything that's inside. But the problem is the sensors you use, which are accelerometers and barometers and all sorts of ometers, you would accumulate error at about 15%. So every 100 feet, you would be off by 15 feet. By 200, you're off 30 feet. And that's not really good. So what you have to do is every 100 feet or so, you had to zero out that error. So you start it all over again, which is why we used the fluorescent lights or some of these other techniques to do that. People worked on this, millions of dollars were spent, and the dead reckoning really never got to the point where it wasn't so cumbersome, where you had to have a whole load of devices on your body in order to get it right. And we really needed to get to where these things could be contained on the ubiquitous device that we all have, which was a smartphone.
Well, I remember, too, just the early trials of indoor, you know, you can look at trying to track down a beacon or some other information, and it might find one within 20 feet, except it would be the floor below you. So you definitely had a lot of earlier challenges to overcome as you've been developing Good Maps.
Yeah, and the beacons did come onto the scene, the Bluetooth beacons, about 7-8 years ago, and Apple came out with the iBeacons. And sure. I was pretty excited about that, and I'd go into an Apple store and nobody knew about them even there. So it took a little while before they caught on, and then lots of companies started implementing them, including Good Maps when we first started, because we took over the American Printing House Nearby Explorer and Indoor Explorer using beacons, and we'd use them at Sendero, my former company. Blind Square used them, La Cerrillo uses them. There's lots of beacon systems out there. But they, having hardware involved in the equation, really presented some challenges to the viability.
So let's backtrack a little bit. You were talking about that conference in Louisville, which I think really was the impetus for a lot of the modern indoor navigation tools that are being developed now. So that led to the founding of Good Maps. So how did Good Maps get started? And tell us about a bit of the trajectory from then until now.
Well, I think that although the Nearby Explorer had some traction in terms of the blindness community, everybody realized that, hey, wait, this is bigger than just the blindness community. And what's key to making a product viable and at a low cost point? It's a high volume, low cost situation. That's why apps are so cheap, you know, 99 cents,
yep.
$2.99. It's high volume. Well, the blindness field by definition has no high volume. So if we could expand to all markets, other disabilities and to the population in general, all of a sudden you'd have a high volume situation. And so that's when APH came up with the idea of spinning off a for-profit company, Good Maps, to do exactly that, create navigation for all.
So when it comes to indoor navigation, what is to you the significance of the importance of it? What's the big picture situation here?
Yeah, well, you know, it makes me first think of GPS when I started working with it in the 90s and even the early 2000s. Everybody would say, oh, that's too much equipment, it's too much of a hassle, it's too expensive.
The big, huge backpack thing.
Yeah, I mean, mm-hmm. It's just, who needs it? I get around fine as it is. Blind or sighted people, nobody thought GPS was really a thing. And it took a while before it did start becoming a thing, really, when the smartphones were moving on from the old Nokia phones, where there was some basic wayfinding, to the iPhone and the Androids that had GPS in 2005, 2010. And then you were getting away from the big bulky devices, the expensive devices. People started using it in the mainstream. But it took that, I'd say 10 years to go from, oh, what a hassle, it's too expensive, it's too heavy, to something that I can't live without.
And I think like so many of the other technology products that we see here at CSUN, like you mentioned, it isn't just a blindness product. You found ways to get into other industries which also have a need for indoor navigation.
You found ways, no pun intended.
Ah, I didn't even do that.
Yeah, well, with indoor navigation, the importance is that the GPS gets you to the building, more or less. If it's in a big parking lot or an outdoor mall or something, it might be a bit off, but it gets you to the vicinity. And then you get to the doorway, and now you're inside. You're in a mall. I don't know about you, but for me, as a blind person, going into a mall was always destination-oriented. Yep. Go to the Radio Shack, go to the Apple Store, get in, get out. And that was a challenge in and of itself. I just went into my first mall experience with Good Maps in Vancouver, British Columbia, a week ago, and I actually enjoyed. I was there ostensibly to be testing this, but I tell you, I had a great time looking for food, finding gifts. I was browsing the mall on my own. When I went in there, they said, oh, well, can we show you around? I said, no, that's exactly what I don't want to do. I want to experience this on my own, like a little kid. I want to do it myself. And I had a blast browsing that mall, because all the stores were marked, it was on multiple levels. I put it into step-free mode and just take the elevator or not and take the escalator and the stairs. I learned my way around, and it was absolutely amazing to realize, hey, for me, this is really the holy grail. You can go to an airport, and it's wonderful to have good maps in an airport like we have in Portland and Portland, Oregon, and Louisville. And it'll take you to the counter through security, down to your gate. That's awesome too. But in a mall, there is nobody. There's no meet and greet person. There's nobody to ask. So it's a, I think it's a highly valuable location for maps.
Yeah, the browsing to me is huge because you're right. You know, usually we just had a destination and that was the place we wanted to go. And you miss out on so many of the other things. Oh, I didn't know there was that restaurant here. Oh, I didn't know that store opened up here in the mall. Let me go check that out. Or maybe I'll go buy their stuff as well.
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely. So tell us a little bit about the technology and how it works. It's here at the Marriott, and we'll get into that in a minute as well. But just in general terms, how does the technology work?
Right. So I talked about the positioning and how do we do that indoors. Beacons mean that you have batteries to deal with. Bluetooth really wasn't designed for positioning. So we soon learned, and actually right at that COVID CSUN in 2020, when everything closed down Friday night when we left, we had beacons set up in the Hilton, and I said, oh man, this is not good. This is really not working well. So we went back, and COVID was a blessing in disguise because it really meant we could go back to the drawing board and say, we got to do something else. And sometimes technology is just all about timing. And the LiDAR that's been used for, by Google on cars, you know, these multi-million dollar systems for mapping outdoors, was getting smaller and cheaper and able to be used in this kind of setting. So that meant that we could image, we could scan a room and get a very precise geocoded image of a room, of a building, and not have any infrastructure to deal with. So you just have an image. You put that image in the cloud, and now you have a map. It's you have to label the map, you have to process it. And over the course of a couple of years now, we've gone from one type of scanner, a Phantasmo scanner, to a Leica scanner. The scanner used to be in a backpack. Now it's handheld, not much bigger than a giant flashlight, easy to carry around. And so it's easy to scan it. It takes the amount of time that it would take to walk this hotel is how long it took to scan. Then that file gets uploaded, processed, tweaked by our mappers. And in this case, we scanned the hotel on Monday because last year we had a different scanner. So we wanted to use the new scanning technology and technique. And Brent scanned the building on Monday, uploaded that, got it processed. We had the floors working on Tuesday. And then as of today, we got the exhibits.
That's really exciting. Marked. Let's talk about the Marriott a little bit and perhaps what you've learned between last year and now. There's a lot of challenges that can come up here. You have a lot of moving pieces and large crowds. And just a lot going on. So this is your second year having the Marriott scan. What have you learned over the past year, and how are you adapting to some of these challenges?
A couple of things. Last year, the lobby area just didn't work well. It's kind of weird with that seating area in the middle, and so you have to circle around. And for whatever reason, maybe kind of an atrium sort of thing, it just didn't work well in the lobby. Then there was another funky area when you get to the market, and there's this little 45-degree left, 30-degree right, and that was a little funky as well. And now that's working beautifully. And the other thing was the time to localize, how quickly, once the camera is tilted up and you're viewing your environment, how long does it take to localize? And that's much quicker. It can happen within a couple seconds. Sometimes it takes a minute. This technology is not without, like every technology, you got to know its strengths and weaknesses to really maximize the use of it. But we've, and of course, the fact that we can process data quicker now within a day, we couldn't do the exhibits last year because by the time they were set up and we got to scan them, there wasn't time left to actually process the maps.
Yeah, it's that dynamic content that's really interesting to me, talking about the exhibit hall, and that's the thing. You're right, it gets set up. The exhibitors are setting up the same time that you're trying to set up and get a map into the system and then have it available for a three-day event and then get it wiped out right away. So you have most of the exhibit hall maps, and how has that been working out?
Yeah, well, we're adding to it as we go. Our mapper is also working at the booth as I speak, so when he gets a minute, he's labeling more of the booths. I think half of them or so are labeled. So you can definitely get the experience. I think it's like the mall, where you just browse, you just walk around. You don't have to find a sighted person to guide you. If you want a specific place, you want to go, you know, from Good Maps to Ira or something, you just...
Kind of how Google Maps will, like, have you go off 8 different side streets, you know, when you...
just made 2 turns. I think it's more like my robotic vacuum at home. I always wonder, why? It seems so random, but it covers everything.
So what are some of the other places? I know you're in a couple of different airports now and some transit stations as well.
It's a pretty wide variety. I'd say if we have a specialty, it's rail stations. The United Kingdom has really taken off in terms of stations that are being mapped, and some of them are pretty big and complicated. So that's been a stronghold for us. Rail in the U.S., there's a BART or a station that we've done. Nobody really wants to be first, and so that's the big challenge with a new technology. Whether it's a mall or a hospital or a university, you need the first one to step up, show that it can be done, and then provide a demo site, because everybody says, hey, I want to see a demo.
Sure.
And that's why it's so nice to have it at CSUN, because a lot of people can get a demo, but that's, not everybody wants to come to Anaheim in California to get a demo.
Well, it's been almost 5 years now, I guess 4 at this point, but we've made so much progress you have with Good Maps, and that whole technology with indoor navigation has come a long way. Where do you see us going in the next 4 to 5 years as far as, where's the near time future? What can we actually see happening in the next couple of years?
Well, I think there's always room for technologies as far as getting cheaper and also more accurate. I mean, the interesting thing about accuracy is that we can get you sub-meter accuracy, so 2 or 3 feet. But when you think about it, when you're walking along, voiceover is talking, the thing says turn left, well, there's a might be 5 seconds from the time it cues you, and people walk at different speeds. Dog people are one way, cane users, low vision, and so there's a people factor that really dictates how the accuracy works out. So I think that'll get better as we use AI to determine specifics about people, so it could adjust to your particular situation. Also, the big challenge, of course, is getting in more and more buildings. Once we have all those firsts and people have more demos, they're going to be implementing it more widely, just the way that GPS started back in the 2000s.
So we'll tell people how to download the app in a second if people want to try it out, either here at CSUN or anyone watching in other places. But perhaps someone that is watching or listening is thinking, man, I have this place locally, and I really think they would be a great candidate for Good Maps. How should they approach that, or who should they get in contact?
Yeah, it is really about crowdsourcing, crowd-influencing this situation. What we need is the right contact. That's always true at any business. How do you get to the right person? And sometimes it's through the accessibility channels. Sometimes it's through the facility person. If somebody had a local mall, if you can get us in touch with somebody, we can pursue it further. But that's really what it's all about, is finding the right people to then take a step further, let them evaluate it, see if it's in their budget. It's not that expensive. It's based on square footage. And so we can easily find out the size of your building or the building that you've recommended and give them a quote. And then the biggest problem is always, how do we get it into our budget?
That's awesome. So we're going to open it up for questions in just a minute, if anybody has any. But first, before we do that, go ahead and tell people how they can go ahead and try out the app, either here at the Marriott or somewhere else.
Yeah, if you want to download it, Good Maps, one word, space, explore, both Android and iOS. That's how you get it in the App Store, Play Store. Also at our booth, there's a QR code that'll drive you to those particular locations. If you want more information, of course, it's goodmaps.com. And we're always happy to help you out at the booth to either download it or get past the initial setup and inquiries about is this okay, is that okay?
And that's booth 109 here.
Yeah,
at
in the Marquee side.
Yep. So definitely go check that out. You have till the rest of the week to do that. And of course, does at the Marriott, by the way, does that remain up?
After? It does. You have indefinitely.
Right. So if somebody were to come back in a couple months, mm-hmm. they could still navigate around for some other conference.
Yeah, the exhibits would obviously be different.
Sure, they're going to go away. But yes.
Who knows what convention you might wander
yeah.
into. Yeah, but right. I thought Good Maps was here.
It'd be really interesting. Yeah, this is who was at this booth. Well, awesome. Well, if anybody has any questions, Dave, we'll track you down. We'll get you a microphone. Yep. We'll be happy to bring you on.
Hope right there.
I believe she was first.
Hi. Thank you for the presentation. It's been amazing. One question I did have was as far as the scope of the Marriott project, because I noticed when I pulled up Good Maps that it only goes to first and third floors. Is there going to be a point, or maybe it's just me, I don't know, but is there going to be a point where it kind of expands in the hotel?
Yeah, we have a special version that screens you out.
I knew it. Honestly, I just figured I didn't know how to use it. So,
I believe Brent has scanned the first floor. I'm not sure what he did with the lower floor and the third floor. He talked about doing sections of that, so we can stop by the booth and find out. The normal process when we do a new building is we come in. I come in sometimes. I test it. I give the mappers feedback. And nobody actually uses it for a couple weeks or a month. So this is the first time we've done it on the fly. And I've run into a couple places that seem to be hiccups that need to be rescanned. I know he did tell me that in the interest of upload files, because these are multi-gigabyte files, that he scanned it in three sections, the first floor. And so he's intending to go back tomorrow, do a single scan so that it doesn't have to be stitched together, and he thinks that that'll help with some of the broken spots. But those are typical techniques that we would use when we implement a new building. So if you do have feedback, I encourage you to let us know. At the end of a route, there's something that says end route, and you tap on that, and then it asks you to rate it on a 5-star basis. There's room for text. And if you can give some specifics about, well, it was great until I got to the end and it made me turn around and go the other way, put in something like that so that, because we look at those log files and that feedback is really valuable.
Yeah, thank you. Really encourage you to test out the technology. That's one of the really cool things I've always loved about CSUN is you get to try the cutting edge. And if you find something, you can go straight to their booth and say, hey, Mike, we just noticed this, or whoever's working there.
We cannot hide.
Yes, and you can get things fixed almost on the fly.
Which is a wonderful segue. Hi, this is Mike. I tried it out earlier, and I did run into that scenario. Turn around, walk 50 feet that way, turn around, walk 50 feet back the way I was coming from. And I think it's just me. I've had about 33 minutes of experience with this. It's CSUN. Is there going to be a demo, a walkthrough, a chance where we could experience this with someone who can give us some guidance? That's question number one.
Yeah, you can. And we also have a researcher at our booth in Good Maps, and she does surveys of users and this kind of thing. She really wants to tag along and document feedback from people as you go. So if you have a minute, that would be useful for us as well as for you to get some tips from us walking along with you.
All right, so the best is to stop by and arrange it with the Good Map. Okay, and question number two is, as things change, for example, you mentioned the exhibit hall, as buildings change, maps change, what happens in that scenario? How is the data updated?
In our contracts, when we do a building, there's something that says, you know, we will rescan up to 10% per year. So if a building, if a wall moves, that would have to be rescanned. There is a portal that manages the data that the venue owner has access to. So they can go onto what's called Good Maps Studio, and if office names change, then they can go in and rename them, or and the exhibits out here, we can rename them. Like, we didn't put booth numbers on the names, and I said, hey, Brent, I think it'd be good if it says Good Maps 109. And there's also a deeper content thing you can add. So those elevators, on-demand elevators, are confusing. So last year, I don't think we've added it this year, but when you went to those Palms or the Oasis, you go to the Palms elevator, and it says more information available. You tap on that, it gives you a brief description. It says cars A through F, counterclockwise, starting on the right, and the push buttons are on the left and the right of the alcove. Some just brief thing that all of a sudden you say, okay, now I at least know where to go. And when it says, you know, go behind you to your right, you're thinking, trying to figure out where that is. This helps you with that extra information.
Thanks, Mike. Do we have any other questions?
Hello, it's Jessica from Vancouver. Where's that mall in Vancouver? That's
Westminster.
My first question. Newest is which one?
The Royal, there's a CNIB hall there.
Oh my God, that's like 10 blocks away from my house. I'm so going there when I get home.
Oh,
amazing.
Nice. That's awesome.
And then
go try it and let me know how it works out.
I totally will. And I had the same kind of feedback where I was trying to use it earlier and it was like, go 50 feet. And then it was like, turn right. And then it was like, turn around. And I turned around and around and around like 5 times. And then I closed it and found a sighted person. So I would love a actual walk to see, you know, it working properly. But it's a very cool concept, and I'm excited.
Yeah. You know, somebody mentioned earlier that maybe there's an issue when there's a lot of people around. And that's not an issue. You know, the scanning techniques take into account things that are moving, people density, and that all gets thrown away when it's scanned. So when the scanning happens is really when, you know, the building is collected, and it's walls and floors and ceilings, not people, that influence that. There's I'm gonna just throw it up, an approximate statistic that as long as you have 60% of the environment within view, within the scope of the camera, then you're good. So 40% of your view could be blocked by people. That is not what's influencing it. There's gonna be other variables that do. Some are mysterious, but so far we've not found people to be a blocker.
So I guess I'm up next. My two quick questions are, one, you mentioned airports. How do you handle secure zones and areas where you may not want all of that data out in the public? And then my second question is around localization or languages, so English, Spanish, or English, French, or what have you. Any plans?
Yeah, with GoodMap Studio, there are permissions, they're role-based permissions. So just like card keys in a business, certain people have access to certain areas. We can do the exact same thing based on your location. We can let only staff into a certain area. And this is very true with corporations like banks. People can't go everywhere. They can only go into public areas or staff members. There might be blind staff members who need access, they can go other places. So it's based on your sign-in. It's usually tied to the email of the company. We've got a number of installations at Intel, for example, and you know, a lot of their facilities are secure and they have blind employees, and so they can use this. So that's, you know, that's how that's handled.
And localization.
Yeah, that's, I mean, that's always an expensive thing because you've got to get somebody to translate it. You don't want to just use Google Translate.
Yep.
So that's just something that is part of the process. We have it in Canadian French and Spanish version, and we'll be adding other languages. We've really focused on English-speaking countries to start with because we really have to get the momentum in terms of number of buildings before we branch out to some of these other countries, but there's a lot of international interest and we want to make more and more languages available. And, you know, within the US, it's not just because it's primarily an English-speaking country. You've got a lot of other languages and people may choose to have Spanish as their primary language, and so we want to be able to deliver the interface that way.
We've got about 10 minutes left. If people still have questions.
We got one here.
All right.
JJ.
All right.
Hey, Mike. What is the roadmap for it, and what more specifically is what are the next set of features?
The next set of what?
Features.
features that you guys are coming out with?
It's a mile long. I mean, I'm the worst offender or advocate.
What are you most excited about?
However you want to look at it. There's so many things I want to see added. I think crowdsourcing, adding user points of interest is really important because since it is so hard to map the world, it'd be nice if we could contribute our own maps. And I focused on this with my Sendero products.
Yep.
We had user points of interest creation and sharing for a long time. So I'd like to see more of that. Good Maps has the outdoors version as well, which is a rebranding of what was CNI GPS before that. And we're just now adding features to that app. I can't say yet what those will be, but I think people will be excited. Probably June-ish timeframe, those will be out. And then also, the Good Maps Explore app is adding a ton of features for its 2.0 release, very much focusing on making it a more visually pleasing app so that we do have sighted customers and users to drive that equation the way that we were talking about earlier. So it'll have maps and blue dots and the kinds of things that people are used to on their commercial apps.
I think that's one of the really big things that you have stressed, right? Because if people are already creating, say, like a store is creating a navigation app for their store, well, they don't want to create two separate apps or two separate experiences. You can provide that all in one experience.
Yeah, and people have seen recently the beta in Scene AI, where you can create some routes in your house, and it's using the LiDAR, SuperSense, Super LiDAR, using LiDAR, Clue, CLEW, using LiDAR on your iPhone. Those are short-range LiDARs. They couldn't be used to map this room or a building, but they can provide some functionality so you can create your own breadcrumbs, if you will, in places that aren't mapped, and that's super valuable. So I'd like to see more integrations of those apps in with our apps, as well as other things like scheduling apps, now that you have hoteling and open desk situations. How do you integrate with those apps that people already have in their companies? Because we're used to using one or two apps. I don't think people want to use 10. And sometimes your whole travel experience involves everything from starting out with your research and booking your flight to taking your Uber to going through the airport and changing gates. So there's a complete trip component that I think can really benefit from companies collaborating, working together.
That makes a lot of sense. Any more questions? Got one more. Awesome.
You got one here and one up front.
Awesome. Got time for both.
Hi, I work with museums and other cultural institutions, and I'm wondering whether you've onboarded any museums with this technology, and if so, how that works, given how often the interior spaces can change.
Oh, I'm glad you mentioned that.
Such a great place, yes.
Yeah, I think next to malls, maybe museums are next on my list. We have the Speed Museum in Louisville, and the neat thing about that experience is the museums that supposedly have accessibility sometimes will have, 10% of their exhibits with some sort of oddball audio device. And you really want access to everything. You want to go at your own pace, find your own stuff. So the way that it works in that museum is I can either just walk around and point the phone and see what's over in the direction I'm walking. Or I can be destination-oriented. I can pick a particular exhibit and guide it to it. And whichever way I do it, I get to the exhibit and I think, what is this? Maybe it's all behind glass, I have no idea. I can tap on the more information button and that now plays for me whatever the museum has decided is the content for that exhibit. Exhibits change, so a lot of times those are just links or QR codes that would have the information online. That information could be either electronic text or it could be an MP3 file, so you actually hear the curator reading the information or the author of that exhibit reading the information. That's the deep content that can be created either personally by the things I was talking about before with your own user points, but in a museum, it can be something that replicates what the sighted person sees on the print plaques.
Great question. I believe we had one more.
One more up front here.
And then we'll wrap it up.
Okay. Hey, Mike, it's Peter. Have you done any testing with external cameras that you might wear so that the phone doesn't have to be always in your hand?
Oh, yeah. Yes, absolutely, because hands-free is so important. We have one hand tied up with a cane or a dog, and then the other hand might be rolling a suitcase. Where's another hand? And so the workarounds right now, to put it in a shirt pocket, and my wife reminds me that she doesn't have many of those. I do. I make sure and buy shirts with a pocket, so I drop the phone in there, the camera's peeking out, and I can use it for Ira, Be My Eyes, or for good maps. I just recently got a lanyard. They call it a neck wallet. And so my badge for CSUN is in this thing. And then there's a little pocket where I drop my phone in. Again, it peeks out, and I'm just letting this hang around my neck, and I'm using it that way. But there are camera glasses. Envision AI is one of them. ARX is another. There's another Vancouver company called Celeste that's coming out with one. I signed up for an early prototype, and they're 4 or 5 months delayed, but hopefully that'll be out soon. And the idea is you've got the camera in the glasses, and that it gives you the hands-free capability for a lot of different purposes, for Ira and Be My Eyes, potentially for good maps, although there's some other things that it's not just streaming video we have to worry about. It's something called AR Kit or AR Core on the phones that we have to interface with. So Apple doesn't currently allow external cameras to be used in the way that we would need to. But these things will change, and I think with a lot of neat hardware on the market, Ray-Ban has some cool camera glasses, Zetronics. I have a couple of pairs, and I use them for different reasons. But I'd really like to see them used for good maps at some point.
Thank you, Peter, and everyone, for all your questions. And also great to see all the enthusiasm for indoor navigation, and we'll definitely be following what Good Maps is up to over the coming, the next 5 years. Mike, why don't you one more time give everyone contact information, how they can learn more?
Yeah, info@goodmaps.com. Come over to the booth, and we can talk more, booth 109 in the marquee side. Thanks very much for coming.
Hi, everybody, and welcome to another session where we're talking about today about Kindle and Prime Video at Amazon and the accessibility of those two areas of our offerings. So my name is Josh Mealy. I am a principal accessibility researcher in Amazon devices, and it's my privilege today to be talking with a couple of Amazon leaders from Prime Video and Kindle, who are working specifically on the accessibility of our products. And so with me today is Pamela Gnarly, a senior manager of product management from Prime Video, and Tara Maisel from Kindle, who is a senior product manager. And we're really gonna be diving deep today on the accessibility of Kindle and Prime Video, what accessibility means in Kindle and Prime Video, and how we are trying to delight our customers with disabilities in these areas where we're offering content for entertainment, education, and all sorts of other purposes people read and watch videos for. So before we do dive into that and really talk about the products and the accessibility work that you do, I'd just like to get to know the both of you a little bit better and have you introduce yourselves to our audience, our listeners. And I'd just like you to mention, how long you've been at Amazon, how you got involved in accessibility, what kind of what your work at in Amazon is like, and anything else you'd like to mention about yourself. Tara, can we start with you?
Sure. Thanks for that introduction, Josh. So as Josh mentioned, my name is Tara Maisel, and I work on the books and retail accessibility team at Amazon. I have a bit of a non-traditional background in how I came to Amazon and my work in accessibility. I previously used to be a teacher. I spent about 10 years as an elementary classroom teacher, mostly teaching fourth grade. And I love that career. Kind of fell into a transition into Amazon close to 9 years ago, where I moved into a role at an ed tech company that Amazon had acquired called 10 Marks. And I worked on building math curriculum for kindergarten through fifth grade students. So I worked on educational materials for teachers and students. And when that business shut down, I rolled into the Kindle org, where I've been for about 4 years. And the last 2 years, I ended up in accessibility. And when I first joined the team, I really didn't know what accessibility was. I literally Googled it. And as I started learning and, you know, onboarding to the team and figuring things out, I realized that, you know, a lot of the work that I had done as a teacher in my previous life really was working. You know, I worked with students with disabilities. I had students with disabilities in my class every year. And the things that I was doing for them to support their learning and education, you know, really resonated with me and helped me as I became a product leader in the Kindle accessibility space, just in a different way, just applying those learnings to the digital world. And so yeah, that's kind of my background. And in my role on the accessibility team, I support teams within Kindle that are building products and features for all of our customers who are readers or shoppers or even authors with disabilities. So again, thank you for having me here.
Yeah, no, it's wonderful to have you here. And I love that you came from a teaching background, because that's, you know, books and literacy and education, they really go together, and accessibility is such a great part of that. Pamra, tell us how you came to be a leader in accessibility in Prime Video.
Yeah, happy to. So I'm Pamra Narly. I am heading a product management function at Prime Video Accessibility Team. And my team's mission is to make Prime Video more accessible for all customers. To be able to do that, we build technology and we build operational workflows so that we can procure movies and TV shows with accessible feature set. Prior to that role, I have been in different roles at Amazon within retail, within Amazon Web Services, over the course of almost 9 years right now. And what brought me to Amazon and also made me stay all these years is what we call customer obsession internally, which is basically like Amazon's strong focus on building the best experience for the customers. And I thought over time that one of the best places to exercise customer obsession is accessibility space, because it is really very critical to put customer front and center in the accessibility space, so that we can understand their needs well, we can build the products, and we can design the product that address those needs, so that the end product, the end experience is really addressing their needs and providing customers a very satisfactory final experience. So yeah, with that motive, I'm every day very excited to be doing my job and to be learning from customers and building with customers.
Thanks so much, Pamra. I mean, you mentioned customer obsession, and I think accessibility really is sort of at the heart of customer obsession. If we at Amazon tell ourselves that we obsess about customers, and we certainly do, then that has to include customers with disabilities, which means we have to obsess on about accessibility and how people use our products in so many different ways. So to sort of riff on that a little bit, I think it's really interesting because accessibility can mean so many different things in so many different areas. So for example, you know, in web accessibility, you know, we have lots of guidelines, we have lots of particular things that we know we need to do to make a website accessible. But it's gonna be a little different for different products. We talked yesterday, for example, about Alexa and what accessibility means for Alexa. And that's certainly not an out of the box type thing. You really have to think deeply about what accessibility means when you're building innovative products. And so I'd just like to ask each of you to kind of think out loud a little bit about about what accessibility means in the context of your product. So Pemra, for Prime Video, when we're talking about customer obsession and accessibility, what does that mean?
That's a great question. So within the context of Prime Video, what accessibility means has, I guess, multiple fronts. So the very first part of accessibility is building the features to make content, make TV shows and movies more accessible. To be able to do that, we build features such as audio descriptions that are primarily designed for customers that are low vision and blind. We build closed captions for deaf and hard of hearing customers. And finally, we build beta stage experimental features so that we can deepen and also enrich the experience of the same customer groups and additionally others. One example I would like to call out here is our beta stage product called Dialogue Boost. So this is a product we are rolling out slowly, and this is built mainly with the hard of hearing customers in mind. So customers, like some of our customers, like tell us that they find it very hard to follow dialogue in certain movies and TV shows, particularly in action movies and TV shows where the background can be super loud when there are car explosions or helicopters chipping in the background. So with Dialogue Boost, we give them the option to boost the dialogue relative to the background sound and effects so that they can follow the dialogue a little bit more clearly, a little bit more comfortably. All these features and building more of those features is definitely a big portion of what accessibility means in Prime Video. Additionally, it is super important for us to increase the number of TV shows and movies with these accessible feature set so that we can provide our customers a large selection that they can choose from to enjoy Prime Video. This requires partnerships with studios that produce those content. That requires us to work with industry-leading localization accessibility providers so that we can generate these features when they are not available. And finally, and last thing that's also super important at Prime Video is to provide customers a good experience across different devices, especially on the mobile devices, living room devices, and web devices as well, so that they can easily navigate in Prime Video, hopefully in a way that doesn't involve too much friction, and in a way that they can find the content with accessible feature set easily.
That is so interesting, and it's really, you know, it really illustrates kind of the diversity of things that we think about. You know, it's not just about content; it's the players and the different interfaces all require deep and careful accessibility thinking. Terry, you're in the books in the Kindle accessibility part of our organization. Could you Tell us how you think about this from your from books. What does book accessibility mean?
Yeah, sure. So at a high level, as I mentioned before, you know, we're all about ensuring that customers have an accessible experience, whether they're from the whole browsing and purchasing of a book, delivering it to their device, reading a book, and potentially even authoring a book as an independent author through our Kindle Direct Publishing program. At a high level, that's what, you know, we're aiming for. And really, it's about removing barriers from the customer experience. One of the mechanisms that we utilize for Kindle to ensure that all features are developed accessibly and are delightful for customers with disabilities is a program that we call the Accessibility Bar Raising Program. And this is essentially made up of volunteer experts in accessibility that consult with all of the Kindle teams building all of the amazing features that they're putting out each year and ensuring that the disability use cases are considered from the very beginning. So we have teams that will bring us, designers that will bring us early, you know, just very early sketches even sometimes of new products or features that they're developing or full design mocks or wireframes. And our team will provide feedback to those teams around, you know, part of it is education about customers with disabilities. Part of it is representing the voice of customer, but a lot of it is just really helping them to look around corners and identify things that might be tricky for certain customers with disabilities. And you know, we'll provide that feedback and help them iterate on their designs from a very early stage so that we're not scrambling to create an accessible experience when the feature is further along in development. So for example, we might identify, you know, some basic things like, oh, there might be a color contrast issue here or a text size issue there. But sometimes it's other things a little bit more complicated, like, you know, you haven't adequately explained the number of steps or what those steps are for customers as they progress through a particular onboarding experience, or it might be around the complexity of language or the use of an icon that's a little less familiar. And so, yeah, we're really trying to look around corners and help support all of the teams to build everything accessibly that we put out for Kindle. And then, of course, our team also specifically will take on the challenge of also developing uniquely delightful features specifically designed for customers with disabilities.
Funny you should mention that. That's I'm really interested, actually, in hearing more about the specific products that you've been working on. You know, we've been you know, hunkered down, locked up, you know, in our home offices for a while, and we've been busy building cool products for our customers. So I wonder, I'd love to hear about some of the products that you've been working on in both of your teams that are particularly delightful for or aimed at customers with disabilities. And, you know, in addition to new products, of course, there are lots of cool products that you've been, you know, that you've been perfecting for years and have been around for a while. I'm really interested in kind of a quick overview from each of you of new products and long-lasting standard products that we've had for a while, but that we're proud of. Tara, why don't you were on a roll. Keep on going.
Okay, thanks, Josh. Well, there's a lot of features in for Kindle that support customers with disabilities. I'm not gonna go through a whole laundry list of them. I did a presentation earlier today that kind of did that, but I'll focus on three features that I think are really representative of how we support customers with cognitive disabilities. And this is especially important in the reading space. You know, these are our Kindle devices and our apps are meant for, you know, getting people to read more and enjoy their reading. And so that can be a big struggle for customers with cognitive disabilities, whether it's ADHD, dyslexia, traumatic brain injury, autism. There's all kinds of people that, you know, want to read books, need to read books, and may struggle for one reason or another. So I'll talk about a few features. One is a feature that we released not too long ago. I call it a small but mighty feature. It's a little tiny button, that's really all it is, and we call it the dictionary audio button. And this feature, what this does is, so you're probably familiar if you've ever read a Kindle book, we have the ability to just sort of press and highlight a word as you come across it in the text, and it brings up the dictionary and it gives you the definition of a word. And that's useful, but we also now have what's called the dictionary audio button, which allows you to hear that word read aloud. And what this does is helps create that, you know, visual to oral connection so you can really hear and understand what that word is supposed to sound like. Because for a lot of us, when we come across words in text and we just see it, it's really hard to make sense of that. And for many users, this is exacerbated. Like, they're coming across multiple words as they're reading, particularly if it's a textbook or something that's a little bit more difficult and above their reading level. So I particularly enjoy that feature, and I gave this anecdote earlier today, but when I was younger, I used to frequently mispronounce certain words because I've just never heard them out loud. I would only see them in text. So for me, my embarrassing one was the word epitome, which I used to think was pronounced epitome, and for the longest time. But you know, once you use a feature like dictionary audio and you can just kind of press it and hear it read aloud, you're like, oh, okay, that makes sense now, and I can connect what that word looks like to what it sounds like. Another feature, it's a little bit older, but it's something that I am particularly proud of that the Kindle accessibility team developed, and that feature is called the Reading Ruler. And this feature is designed to help users to stay more focused on the text as they're reading and tracking with their eyes, because for a lot of users, reading long-form text can be very distracting. It can be hard to track word to word or line to line. And having, you know, a full page of text in front of you can be daunting or overwhelming for some users and kind of create a sense of like being frozen at the screen. So we have the reading ruler, which is designed to mimic a physical ruler that a teacher might use with a student, but it's available digitally. And so you can customize that reading ruler, and it essentially overlays a block of color across the screen, and you can customize different colors or the opacity. You can make it really transparent or really opaque. You can change the size and the style and use it. It essentially blocks out text on either side or under, or you can use it as an underline device to kind of move through the text and track and help keep you focused. And then the last feature I'll talk about is actually an Alexa feature, but it works hand in hand with Kindle, and we call it the Kindle Assistive Reader. And this is a feature where you can just ask Alexa to go ahead and read your Kindle books to you, and Alexa will read out loud. It will pick up where you left off in your Kindle book. If you were reading on Alexa, you can go back to your device later and read, but you can ask Alexa to read faster or slower, and any books that are in your Kindle library will be read aloud to you. So that's a fantastic one, and I think one that, while designed to support customers with disabilities, is also really useful by a variety of people, whether it's, you know, a child who can't read the book on their own just yet, or you know, if your hands are busy for a moment, you just need Alexa to pick up where you left off. So, yeah.
Awesome, Tara. The epitome of cool features. Thank you. So, Pamra, I know that you guys in Prime Video have been super busy doing awesome things. Tell me more about what kinds of features you've released lately, or what you're working on that you can tell us about, and if you want to sort of open that up to a broader question, I just would love you to tell us more about the features that that Prime Video offers that are delightful for our customers with disabilities.
Within the context of Prime Video, it will be a combination of like new features that I would like to talk about, and also some other initiatives that perfect existing feature set. So it is like both of these aspects has been really big focus areas for us. So first of all, as mentioned briefly previously, one big area of focus is to increase the number of movies and TV shows with audio descriptions and closed captions. We primarily do that by partnering with studios who produce the content and procuring those as accessibility assets from them directly. But when there are gaps, we also build the operational workflows to partner with the leading localization and accessibility providers. And also we build the technology so that we can support them so that they can generate these assets in scale. So that has been a really big focus for us. And as a result of that focus, we were able to, for example, in the case of audio description, able to procure a lot of human narrated audio descriptions. But when they didn't exist, we were able to build text-to-speech-based audio descriptions so that we can create more and more content, introduce more and more content with audio descriptions to our low vision and blind customers. So that has been a real big focus. Second one is the quality aspect of audio descriptions and closed captions. So this again requires us to build like operational workflows to identify the errors that might deteriorate the viewing experience of the customers and improve them. I will take closed captions as an example here. So we basically have humans in the loop to identify issues with closed captions, as well as automated detectors that identify problems such as like closed captions being out of sync with the audio. We automatically detect and are able to correct the issues like that. Or let's say we have also detectors that identify identify spelling mistakes in closed captions, or we are able to identify and correct line count issues, because we are not supposed to pass a certain line count in our closed caption displays. So the big focus basically has been in building the workflows and technology to detect and correct those. And finally, in the new feature set, a feature that we have recently started rolling out, I mentioned briefly, is Dialogue Boost. So this is a beta stage product at this point, and it's available on very select Amazon Originals TV shows and movies. Like a couple examples would be like a highly popular Tom Clancy's Jack Ryan. I hope many people in the audience are familiar with it at this point. Or Emmy winning Miss Maisel, Bosch. Or on the movie side, we have Being the Ricardos, and Ironos as an example. We started rolling out with this feature. It definitely has been a big area of focus for us and continue to be so as we roll it out to a much larger part of our catalog with Amazon Originals content as well as the third-party content.
Thank you so much, Pamra. You've had a lot going on. You mentioned so many different products, and I think, you know, I want to kind of tie these products and the work you're doing back to what we mentioned earlier about customer obsession. So, you know, at Amazon, we focus very heavily on what our customers need, how we can improve our ability to deliver value to our customers and delight them with new products, better products, faster, less, more inexpensive products. So customer obsession really drives everything we do. And we need to, of course, in order to know what will delight our customers, we need to get lots of input and feedback, and we need to interact with our customers. So different parts of Amazon do that differently. And in order to get feedback and input from our customers with disabilities, what special things are you able to do in that space, Pamra?
So what we do at Prime Video accessibility team is basically starting with identifying the needs of customers, and this will be inclusive of customers with accessibility needs. We need to understand like every stage of their customer journey. The point they turn on their device to stream content, the point that they search for content on Prime Video, and all the way to streaming. And to identify the needs in that customer journey, we basically look into a few different channels. One of them is our customer support channel. This is where customers proactively reach to us to give feedback and inputs on our feature set. We also have closely track our social media accounts to see what other feedback we are getting from the customers. And finally, we also do like customer research ourselves as well to ask customers with disabilities specifically what they like about our features, what they want to see. And we connect quite a bit with customer advocacy groups as well in a similar fashion to get their inputs on our existing features or on the features that currently doesn't exist, but they might like to see on Prime Video. So all these inputs collectively give us a great starting point in terms of what customers like on Prime Video, what they might like to see more of, and where they see the gaps, which is the opportunity for us to do better and better for the customer. And with that input in mind, we start designing our products, and we put together early versions of our products and continue doing user research so that we can validate our products until they come to the finish line. So that's pretty much how we involve the customers. But the other important aspect I think to mention here is we partner with a couple other parties closely as well, one of them being the regulatory authorities in territories where Prime Video is available. We definitely partner closely with content producers, which is studios in this case. We partner closely with localization and accessibility service providers. And we partner with accessibility experts and technologists so that we can get their very valuable input as well. And by the way, events like CSUN are great platforms for that, where all these parties come together and we have the opportunity to discuss like what the customer wants, what the trends are, and what can we do better collectively to delight the customer with accessibility needs. So thanks once again to the organizers like to provide that opportunity.
Great point about how valuable conferences like CSUN really are for us to hear from our customers. We're not just here to tell you what we're doing. We want to hear about what you're doing with our products and how we can be doing better. Tara, what about from a Kindle perspective? What do you do to connect with and hear from your customers who have disabilities and what delights them?
Sure. So I think there's a lot of overlap here with what Pemra spoke about. On the Kindle side, we look to voice of customer data from multiple sources and seek out those viewpoints from customers, whether they are, you know, commending and loving certain features that we have or asking for more bells and whistles on the existing features or complaining about our lack of support for something or another. And so we look at multiple channels there, whether it's social media, app store feedback, conference feedback. We look to experts in the field. We look at regulatory requirements. We look at industry advancements and expectations that customers have about anything related to the reading space or the ebook space. We pour through that data and information, and it helps feed our roadmap. And when it comes to, you know, taking those ideas to development, you know, we think about when we're working on the requirements and of what we actually want to build, making sure that, you know, we're not just designing features that are for, you know, the keyboard and mouse desktop users, but that we're considering, you know, all of the different accessibility use cases. Part of the whole life cycle of product development, from going from, you know, what the customer needs are and working backwards from there and doing that customer research, like we talked a little bit about, and building the product and making sure that our requirements are inclusive and all of those things I mentioned earlier with regard to our accessibility bar raising program. We also have to think about the, you know, after we release the product and how we get the feedback on, you know, things that we put out there, because we're not always certain that it's going to land with customers, and making sure that we're evaluating the metrics in the right way. So for a lot of our accessibility features, we're not just looking at, you know, all up usage, for example, of a feature, because we might not expect, you know, everybody to be using a feature in Kindle, because reading is a very personal experience and different people are going to interact with an ebook reader, like an e-reader, or an app, like the Kindle for iOS app, for example. And so we look at continued use and retention of a feature more so necessarily than we might look at all up usage of the feature, if that makes sense.
Thanks, Tara. That is that does make sense. And I think, you know, what I want to, we talked about features, we talked about customer obsession. And I know, you know, when you do talk to your customers about the features that we have, are there any unsung heroes in the family of features? Are there any features that we have or products that we offer that you are surprised that customers don't know more about, or that you wished people were more aware of? And let's start with you, Tara, and we'll try to be done in our allotted 10 minutes.
I'll try to be brief. I think one thing that actually surprises me a lot when I hear from customers is that when they hear Kindle, they just think e-reader. And although e-readers are an amazing reading dedicated device, we can read Kindle content on a lot of different devices. And so, you know, you might have the Kindle app on your phone or Fire tablet. And in many ways, this is useful for customers, particularly if you have a particular type of assistive technology that you're accustomed to using and, you know, you want to kind of use that to read your ebooks. So if you're used to the VoiceOver screen reader on iOS, you know, use the Kindle for iOS app rather than, you know, the e-reader. And the fact that we can pick up right where we left off, we read on one surface and pick up on another, that actually, a lot of people don't realize that. And in addition to the three features I mentioned earlier, you know, I think one other thing I would say is that you can customize your text in a lot of different ways, everything from your line spacing to your margins, background colors, and things like that, which really provide a really personalized reading experience. And that we're really, you know, we're really specific and when it comes to designing the UI, the user interface of the Kindle app, I think we are very intentional about the way we minimize distractions and jargon and, you know, little things that can kind of help create a more accessible experience with the whole app or the reading itself. So
I love that customizability is you know, sort of what your go-to on that, because I think, you know, very often customizability is at the core of accessibility. So I love that Kindle is so flexible in that way. Pamra, how about you? What are the unsung heroes of the Prime Video accessibility world that you'd like people to be more aware of?
I think I will go back to the dialogue boost feature I previously mentioned about, because it's very new and there's a lot of surprising things about it at this point. It is, for example, we definitely expected customers to like it, but one of the surprising things is how often they use it once they try it. So that has been a really interesting thing for us to see. And the second part of it, I think this happened a lot with Dialog Boost, but other Prime Video features such as closed captions as well. You build it as an accessibility feature for the audience that might have, with certain disabilities, but all of a sudden it becomes very valuable for customers that might not necessarily have the disabilities. For example, with Dialog Boost, what we are seeing is customers who might not have, although it is built for customers that have hearing disabilities, tell us that their families and friends who are not hard of hearing also like to turn it off, especially in certain settings such as, you know, loud environments or when they stream content in public places where it is really hard to follow the dialogue. So this, you know, effect that build, like all of we, like the reminder for us once again, we are building accessible products for the community with accessibility needs, but many times it is really so amazing to see that it is helping for everyone. So seeing that over and over again, I guess it's a little bit surprising and also very, you know, delightful and amazing because it makes it, you know, even more motivating for us and even more motivating, I think, for the community as well.
Thank you, Pamra. I totally agree with everything you said. I also want to look a little bit ahead in a couple of sentences, you know, very briefly. We don't talk about unreleased products at Amazon. We will tell you about it when we release it. But speaking generally, what can people expect from Kindle and Prime Video accessibility going forward? Pamra, just real briefly.
Well, people can expect more movies and TV shows with closed captions, audio descriptions, and dialogue boosts. Definitely more focus on like the quality aspect of closed captions and audio descriptions. For the case of audio descriptions, this will be inclusive of script writing quality, audio mixing quality, and text-to-speech voice quality. Finally, people can expect like a continued partnership and continued collaboration with customer advocacy groups so that we can get their input for old and new features that we are building.
Thank you, Pamra. Tara, what can people expect from Kindle accessibility in the future?
I would echo what Pamra said, and one of the things that I think I'm personally excited about is solving some of the challenges around how to create more accessible content. And, you know, the big challenges there are around fixed layout content, image-heavy content like comic books, and things like that, and how we can create a more accessible reading experience for customers who are reading those types of ebooks, and also being able to communicate better with customers about the accessibility of these ebooks prior to purchase, so they know exactly what they're getting and really understand some of the nuances around, you know, the accessibility of the ebooks.
Thank you so much. For folks who want to learn more or get in touch with your teams, what can we tell people? How can people be part of the voice of our customers? Tara?
Sure. Well, I think the easiest place to go would be, you know, amazon.com/accessibility, and there's also amazon.com/Kindle accessibility. So that would be probably my first thing I'd say to check out. And
there's lots of information there, and they're both wonderful sources of information. And of course, you can always contact customer service. We have dedicated accessibility customer service representatives who understand about accessibility features and so on. Pamra, what would you like to leave people with? Is there are there any sources of information or ways to get in touch?
Yeah, definitely amazon.com/accessibility is a great place to start for anything accessibility related within Amazon. And this includes Prime Video, accessibility initiatives, and customer support channels as well. Additionally, we have two specific email channels. If you want to give us feedback on audio descriptions, you can email us at audio-description-feedback@amazon.com.
That's audio-description-feedback@amazon.com.
Right, exactly. And if you want to give us feedback on closed captions, you can email us at pv-captions-feedback@amazon.com.
To say it again, it's PV for Prime Video dash captions dash feedback at amazon.com. That's great. That's really great. I'm sure there are many people listening and watching who would love to give us feedback and get in touch. And so I want to encourage people who are here at CSUN to come by the Amazon booth, number 103, look at the CSUN schedule for other Amazon presentations. And it is just such a pleasure to have been here with you, Pamra and Tara, to discuss the accessibility of Kindle and Prime Video. I want to say thank you to both of you, and thank you to our audience today.
Same here. Thank you, Bhujesh. Thank you, everyone.
Hello and welcome to the CSUN ATC TV studio. This is our last event of the day. It's establishing a digital accessibility program at a large enterprise. And joining us is Monica Goel, who's an executive director of digital accessibility for CVS Health. And we've got a whole slew of questions for her today because she's done some amazing things over there at CVS Health. But the first question was one I had down on my list until we talked about this earlier. And she says, no, that has to be the first question. I said, okay, so the first question is, how important is it to ensure that accessibility team is diverse and inclusive?
Hi, Dave, and happy to be here. So most of my team that's sitting out here, they probably recognize the fact that Monica told you what question to ask first. So the reason why I said to begin with that question is because that's how I established my program. So when I first started at CVS and got accessibility back in late 2018, I had a team of about four, including me, and two of the individuals on the team were people with disabilities. And the amount of information, knowledge that I gained from just talking to them, working with them, just seeing them in their, environment, you cannot find that in a book. You're not going to learn about these things in a book, in a TV show, because there's no representation, or rather limited representation in TV or other places. So from that point, I started a team, and as I built my team, I made sure that we had a very inclusive team, because when somebody new joins your organization, right, and the very first thing you do with them is onboard them. Well, if you don't have the right devices, the right technology, the right tools, you're not going to onboard them correctly. But that allows you to connect with people within the other side of your organization, like the IT organization that's, procuring tools. Well, at the time of procuring tools, that's another bell that rings and says, do you have the right processes in place at time of procurement to bring in the right tools? So as I, you know, brought the inclusive team, you know, built my team, that's how I really got into working with all the different parts of the organization, from IT, from accommodations, from HR, from talent acquisition. All of those things came together to really inform. So a person's first 2 weeks in an organization will help you identify all of the things you need to make sure that your organization is ready to do and have in place to really be able to bring them in.
Excellent. Give us some perspective how this process starts. Can you help us understand the business risk and compliance requirements that are needed when you have to comply with when establishing a digital accessibility program?
So that's, you have to understand the business you're in, because one size will not fit all. You can be in an airline industry, you're in healthcare industry, you're a pharmacy. You have to understand the business model to understand where your risks lie. If you have you look at your product, you look at your services, who are you selling to? If your only objective or, you know, your audience that you have or your consumers that you have, you look at them one dimension, or look at them as, if you're somebody without a disability, mm-hmm. you may just assume that everybody's like you.
Right.
So if you stop and think about what your business model is, and look at the customers, and then think about it from the perspective of, will there be customers with disabilities? You know, will they, you know, would somebody be blind, somebody have low vision, somebody have a mobility issue, auditory issue? If you think about it in that perspective, you will have a better idea of knowing what your business risks are. Mm-hmm. And that will help you establish an accessibility program that says, where do I want to focus first?
Gotcha.
I've spent a better day here today where everybody says, stop boiling the ocean, stop trying to do everything. So I would encourage everybody to take a look at what your business model is, what's your information, how much of you are in the digital space, and then establish a program and then go after where you have the biggest impact first. Learn from that.
Now, CVS Health is a huge company. I mean, I thought at one point Aetna had bought CVS Health. CVS Health bought Aetna.
That is correct.
Give us how many employees are you?
300,000.
300,000 employees. How do you go about establishing a digital accessibility policy company-wide in a company like that?
So at CVS, we were lucky. They already had something. And they were pretty much wanting to have a broader, more effective, So what we did was we took what we had and we made it more robust. We included from both the colleague perspective, the customer perspective, and in this case, you know, for us, because we're a healthcare company, so you've got members, patients, and everybody, so we accounted for all of that. But with that said, for somebody who doesn't have an accessibility policy, you understand the business, you understand the business risks, you reach out to your legal department, you reach out to your compliance department, you reach out to your HR, you have conversations with people to figure out that and then make the case for having an accessibility policy. I'm leading with disability.in. I'm a co-chair for the accessibility program. We're in the process of drafting something that will be made available to anybody who wants it. So it'll have an outline of a policy that you can really take and tweak it to meet the requirements of your organization.
When you first arrived and started this 4 years ago, what kind of response did you get when you started out?
For accessibility to begin with?
Yes.
So again, I was lucky because back in 2019, we were doing accessibility, but there was an organization within Aetna that had an accessibility program. I was asked to lead accessibility for just the Aetna Health asset. Which was, you know, the flagship product for Aetna as a health insurance platform. Didn't know anything about accessibility for. So in 2018, October, we were at a PI planning event. One of my colleagues saw me speaking about something, and I don't remember what that topic was, but at that time they were leading security and accessibility, so they went to their boss and said, hey, I think Monica would be good at accessibility. So I got a call from my boss at that time and said, do you want to do accessibility? I said, sure. And the conversation was over, and I put phone down, and I Googled accessibility. Didn't have a clue about accessibility. I didn't even know it existed, the fact that I even saw it on, you know, on your TV or on your phone as an option. Never looked at it, so didn't really know about it. But with that said, I've been in the industry for 30 years, you know. I started as a developer and, you know, project manager and delivery manager and program manager. So I knew what it was. And the mandate that was given to me was, tell us how to do it right. That was the mandate from leadership. And the program that was in place at that time was after the fact. So if you're going to build something for a quarter and you put it into production and then you have it audited by an external party, and then they tell you what the issues are, by the time you get the issues, you already moved on to the next release. So it was just a cycle that was never ending, and it was just grinding. It didn't really provide any value. So I asked everyone, I said, what do we need to do? What do we follow? And they go read WCAG. And that was not very helpful for somebody who didn't know anything about it. It was overwhelming, to be honest. But then, you know, you give a problem to an engineer, and the first thing they do is just pull it apart, break it down, and figure out what the different pieces are. And I just looked at the product development lifecycle and figured out, you know, you fix anything once in production, it costs you 16 times more than if you did it right at the very beginning. So how does product look at something? How does design look at something? So that's where I went back to the board, and we said, you know, this is where I'm going to start. And then I went ahead and, you know, hired a bunch of really smart people.
Interesting. You mentioned design. How do you establish an inclusive design program and accessibility design system?
Have an inclusive design team. Uh-huh. You have to have people with disabilities, varying disabilities, to be part of it. Because, again, it's, you know, you think about a product owner. They're building products to serve the community, you know, and consumers. But if they don't think about the customer in all, you know, their forms, it's a key element they miss. Mm-hmm. You know, because most people design something like, how do I use this? How would I use this? But if you don't have the right people with you, you're not going to think about what is this person's need versus what is this person's need, not just about me or all that look like me. So so we have an inclusive design team made up of people with all types of abilities, disabilities, and they work very closely with the product team. They do user research. They reach out to communities. And they provide feedback from people with disabilities on the features being developed back to product. That informs them, that helps them bring that perspective into their product and into the design. So if you get it right here, you're going to have less problems at the end of it.
How do you build out accessibility test standards and methodology? Where do you start there?
So, again, you know, being in the IT industry for 30 years, and I'd like to say this, you know, when I was a developer, there was only one person. We were it. You had business, they gave us the requirements. There wasn't anybody translating the requirements. We got them directly from them. We built it. We tested it. And then we had business that did the UAT. We've taken that role and we've split it so many. But having been in that position, I know the different parameters. So what we did was, we started slowly. We also took what was also established by a lot of, you know, organizations in terms of the testing methodology. But it was as taking the you know, success criteria, segmented them based on where it made sense, from keyboard testing to, you know, digital communication channels, color, contrast. So when we did that, we looked at the tools that we had internally. And then we came up with, again, it's not something you can come up overnight if you don't have really good people on your team. So we did that, and we broke it out, and we said, this is the testing methodology we're going to follow. So we, you know, you take one, you describe it, you identify the applicable assistive technologies, the platforms, the browser combinations that you want to use. So we broke it down, and we started with, I'm not going to name any vendors, but we did start off with something that was already there. And then over the past 3 to 4 years, we've simply iteratively modified that made more sense to us. Things and adapted it. And, you know, with new success criteria coming out and the experience that we have gained from, you know, releasing something, learning from it, making mistakes, had us, you know.
So it becomes a customized solution in the end.
Yes, in a way. I mean, you'll be using screen reader, you'll be doing screen reader testing, keyboard testing. Some of that is pretty standard, but how do you look at, you know, I was talking to somebody earlier today, success criteria and how it's understood or interpreted could be different, could have some, you know, different perspectives, but how do you look at it? How do you start with it? What do you define? How do you test for a specific, you know, success criteria? You come back 6 months later, there might be something, new technology that's in place, and you go, oh, I need to tweak it. So it's constant. So every quarter, we have dedicated team members that iterate on our testing methodology, our test plans, our findings and our recommendations, yeah.
Interesting. Now, how do you ensure accessibility is taken into account when you contract an outside vendor?
So it started with the first question. So when you have some, you know, when you start bringing people into the organization that have needs, you realize the huge gap that exists today in procurement. When people that are procuring the tools and products and services, they don't account for it. So one of the things that we did in CBS was we wrote the accessibility clause. We got it reviewed by legal. We got it reviewed by the compliance team. We got procurement's buy-in. We got leadership buy-in. And now it's a clause for when you're procuring something, if it has an impact, it's going to be used by colleagues, customers, consumers. It has to be accessible. It's fun. And the vendors have a great time, you know, trying to say, well, really? We have to. Yes, you have to. If your product is going to be used by colleagues, it has to be accessible.
And does it work the same way for strategic partnerships? Like, I know the CVS I go to is within a Target. I mean, does a customer come out of one environment of accessibility and come into a much better one in CVS, or do you guys parallel your work together?
I don't want to break any relationships with Target or anybody. I don't know if I want to go there. But I think we're all doing
our... You work together on the whole thing.
So, So the Target stores,
right,
which has the CVS, so that's the physical accessibility of it.
Got it.
So within the physical accessible space, what they have to look at is if I'm in a wheelchair, can I go into the aisles? Can I reach? So I'm not in the physical accessibility space, but I partner very closely with them,
yep,
because it is one of those things that I want to know as much as possible, because when we are placing kiosks or health hubs or, you know, lockers in our stores, we have to account for it because some of those things have digital aspects to it. So I've learned a lot, but it depends if it's CVS Pharmacy within Target. So they will probably come together to make sure it meets the standards for physical accessibility.
Now, what's the progress involved with accessibility conformance reporting?
So right now, the biggest problem with the conformance reporting is the fact there's no standard scoring model. Everybody establishes their own. I've established my own, looking at the success criteria. You know, we've come up with what do we believe. I mean, it's not just out in the space. I mean, WCAG does provide guidance on which are best practices, which ones are important, but you take you look at those success criteria and you come up with which success criteria have more weight than others, and that allows you to come up with a weight model. And when you do that, internally we are able to assess our products, our services, every feature that we develop, and how they score. But I can score one way. Another organization that audits me and my, you know, our products may score me differently. But just as long as the defects are around the same, you know, but yeah.
So what's the process, can you describe, that you go through when you address your digital accessibility program from the customer's perspective?
So from the customer's perspective, you know, the one thing we, as I was talking to earlier, was the user research, right? We do it early. It wasn't always the case, but we have been doing it regularly since I took over the accessibility at CVS in 2020. In partnership with the design accessibility team that does the inclusive user research. So that's the early, and then you have, a customer service, customer feedback, voice of the customer surveys that you have. So all of those different channels. We also look at, when something launches, releases. So for example, CVS, released Spoken Rx, which is a prescription read aloud. And it's basically you go to your pharmacy, you say, pharmacist, and say, I want Spoken Rx. They sign you up. All your prescriptions come with an RFID chip at the bottom. You use your iPhone, Android phone, whatever, scan it, it reads out your prescription. So we have launched it into the market. We want feedback. So we will go out to the communities. We will work with organizations, tell them about what we're doing, have them sign up. We've got a booth in here, so, you know, the intent is to get working with organizations that are in this space, help get the word out. It's free, so it's not, it doesn't cost, but, when you're saying if I want to do something directly for the, community, then developing these products, getting the community to accept that product allows us to demonstrate the value and also help encourage our leaders to say, you have this segment of the population and your product is being received in this way. So let's innovate in this space more.
And how long has the Spoken Rx been out?
About a year.
A year. So you've gotten some feedback on it already.
Yeah.
Excellent. So what are some of the future challenges you see that are coming down the road that you're developing solutions for now in anticipation of them arriving?
Oh, God. I think right now...
It's got to be an iterative process, so you're always coming up on new challenges that...
I think there's enough challenges in the accessibility space today.
Right.
I just feel, I feel good where we are in the sense of all the work this team has put together to establish something that is supported in the organization by everybody at all levels. Sure, we have challenges. I don't want to say it's all, hunky-dory, but there is so much more. I spent 2 days at CSUN. And I have a laundry list of things like I want to do more. So I think at this point in time, I just want to be able to do more for the community, get, basically establish CVS Health as an organization where the community feels, yes, CVS Health is listening. Yes, CVS Health is innovating for us. We are not just somebody as an afterthought. We are at the forefront of it. And that's what my aim is.
If you could turn the clock back to 4 years that you've been going through this, when you began the process of establishing the program, what would you do differently?
Honestly, I say this before. I made so many mistakes, and from those mistakes, I learned a lot. So I'd go back and probably, still be making mistakes. I don't know if I would, because I didn't know anything. As I said, I literally had to Google accessibility. What I would really like to change is the fact that when I came out of college and I worked in various organizations, I would have loved to have known about accessibility. So it was a huge wake-up call that I'd been in this industry for almost 20 plus years, and I came to know about accessibility for the first time in 2018. So that's what I want to change.
Excellent. So we're going to open this up to questions, because I'm sure there's some out there. And Let's go ahead and do that, Mike. I don't know if you've got your mic ready. Does anybody have any questions? Got one over here.
Thank you so much. Awesome chat. Love the format, by the way. Monica, a couple times you mentioned the idea of Googling about accessibility when you first started. And my entry into the field was really different. Working at DQ, I had Dylan and Preeti to handle me through it. And I'm curious, what's the, as somebody starting out from that point of view, what's the first truly helpful piece of information or guidance, except for WCAG? Let's leave WCAG out, obviously, there. What's the first truly helpful piece of guidance, mentorship, partnership, or information that you came across?
The two people that were part of my team at that time. And there was I had, because of the PHI, I'm not going to name names, but at that point in time, the person who led design accessibility and leads accessibility, design accessibility, who's my partner, she and others on the team, they were instrumental in guiding my path. I mean, I remember meeting them for the first time, and I'm a dog lover, and my colleagues had guide dogs. And I learned very quickly by talking to them about when, you know, if they're in harness, they're on duty. If you want to pet them, you have to wait, all of that. So, but the team members that I had at that time, they were instrumental. They helped, you know, I would ask them questions. I would, try to understand, their experiences, what they've been doing. How did they, get to this space? How do they think about accessibility? How does it impact them? All of those perspectives really understood, because the engineering part, because I'd been an engineer for 30 years, that wasn't difficult. But to really break accessibility down, at the end of the day, in all honesty, accessibility from an engineer's perspective was, am I coding it correctly? Right, but that doesn't solve the problem. You can have a really, somebody's at one time, if you think about a page, and if somebody made every letter, readable from a screen reader, but the information isn't structured or the heading isn't structured, that's not accessible, because something I can scan and get to quickly where I want to be versus somebody who has to read every single word on that page to get to information. That's not accessible. That is, so it was really the people that I worked with that really helped guide me, because reading the 37 success criteria wasn't going to help me solve any problem on day one, for sure.
You didn't have a PhD in WCAG, come on.
That's true. I'm still working on that one.
And how many people are on a team for accessibility policy development that is in a company of 300,000 people?
We are a team of 100 at CVS Health today, but I learned something from someone today who basically said, people come to her and ask her, how many people do you have in the accessibility team? And she goes, 160,000. So yeah. I want to get to the point where I can say 300,000 people at CVS are people that are focused on accessibility. That's what I'm cheating.
and the makeup professionally of the 100, is it mostly engineers or?
We've got engineers, we've got product, we've got
And you interface with the marketing team too.
So within the CVS organization, the groups that I support colleague-facing IT organizations, so that develops software for the colleagues. I support digital consumer facing, support marketing, support HR, talent acquisition, reasonable accommodations. You can think about, procurement, legal, think about anybody. So in 4 years, CVS's accessibility team is literally at every pulse point within the organization.
And it's always in an advocacy mode, probably, to get out the word to the marketing department.
So
Yes, that's true from the marketing side, but the one thing we did, which launches this year, is we got accessibility to be part of one of our compliance trainings. So every employee that joins the organization will have will get to see and hear about accessibility day one. So that will get the message out how many people of the 300,000 will register it. Initially, don't know, but at least we're making our way.
Other questions? Didn't mean to jump in there.
Yep. Oh. No, good. It's okay. Hey, Monica. Great discussion, by the way, guys. And it's awesome to go into a meeting or presentation with no PowerPoint slides and just have a discussion. Monica, what's your North Star, like, from an accessibility standpoint?
Oh, God, I can't see that North Star right now. There's so much I want to do. To give you an example, Jennison told me, calm down. For God's sake, Jenny from Microsoft says, stop, you're going to burn yourself out. So at CVS, I really want our organization to be recognized as somebody that's making a difference in this community. That's really what I want it to be. And I want leadership to start thinking about accessibility as a core. Trust me, if I go talk to anybody, they don't say, we don't want to do it. It's a lack of understanding or how it impacts them. So if I can, the CVS motto for accessibility is educate, enable, and empower. So as far as I'm concerned, that's applicable to whether it's the CEO or the person at the front, in the front store. So I really, my North Star is really to be making a difference in this community through products and services, but not just from a CVS's perspective, but from the accessibility team's perspective, get materials. So CVS is currently developing two apps. One is an Android accessibility techniques app, and another one is the iOS. We're going through the internal open source process at CVS, just through all the checks and balances. But that's going to be something we put out there for the community to use. It's open source. We have developed it. We want people to contribute to it. We're going to be releasing trainings that we're developing that anybody out there can use. I haven't found a lot of good trainings out there, so I'm going to build some. Again, I in here is my team of, of 100, so.
Other questions?
Yeah. Hi, great fan of CVS Inclusive Research Team. Curious about was there any point in time that you found it really hard to bring a new team on board or a new business unit? Just curious if a team is doing really well in accessibility, but you're highly dependent on another team like developers or QA or engineers. How did you go about changing that culture or driving that forward to different people internally?
Well, I've made a lot of, I would say, allies within CVS. And various for example, the person who leads the reasonable accommodations group, or the person who leads the IT side of the organization that's focused on colleagues. So I've really worked with at the leadership level to drive change. So once you have leaders that are supportive of the work you're doing, then the people below tend to So I remember going to IT lead, and I went to his four towers, and I went and spoke to each one of his four towers, and I literally sat with their teams and looked at the assets that they had and basically spoke about it in the context. But again, the one thing to remember is I'm not the only one out there. Because I have an inclusive team, because I have leaders on my team, so my team is from my leadership to all the way to the testers, it's all inclusive, people with disabilities. So I'm not the only one. Sometimes it's just as simple as
Going to the CVS store with a team of, you know, people with and without disabilities, and when you know, your peers see them, it's like a light bulb goes off, right? So the biggest problem most organizations have in the accessibility program is they really don't have inclusive team members. So the story to tell is very, very hard. Think, we need JAWS for testing. Why do you need JAWS? Well, now you need JAWS because you have colleagues that use it. So, you know, so it's really about building relationships. I'm not so sure I'm still liked very much, you know, because it is something you keep doing, but yeah. Building relationships, I think, is key. It's not just networking outside, but networking internally also goes a long way. But I have the chief compliance officer on speed dial. How's that?
You know. Other questions?
Hi, thank you, Monica. I just was wondering, because you have about 100 different employees now under you in your area, how you build out that professional path. That's one thing I'm struggling with a little bit to understand. You can't have 100 just analysts or something like that, but accessibility, the path isn't really very clearly defined. I didn't know how you were doing that.
So the 100 people, obviously, it's. Let me give you some idea about how my organization is structured. So I have a team lead that focuses on innovation and solutioning. So when I look at, you know, the question came up earlier, like your testing methodologies, it didn't come up overnight. We took what the industry had, but then we iterate. So there's a team that focuses on, you know, what our test plans are, our testing strategy, our methodology, but then also looks at what can we do better, right? So if I look at just Spoken RX, we launched it recently. It's still in its tech, you know, there's so much more to do, but just having Siri say, you know, read my prescription, as opposed to open my app, go to pharmacy, find Spoken RX, but if I do that. So there's a team that focuses on innovation, and then there's a leader that focuses on customer experience, both front and at every space. So if you're, they partner with the design team on to understand that the user research level, then customer service, voice of the customer feedback, all of those areas that they connect with. Then I have somebody who's leading a training program. I have somebody who's leading the conformance side of the world. So it's really, so to be able to give people an opportunity to grow in this space, you know, education is huge. So we have, you know, the training, so somebody whose abilities are more about, I want to educate, you have that as a career path. Conformance is a career path. Innovation is a career path. But that's why it's really critical. If you know your business and you understand and the consumer and you're able to identify products and services that will meet their needs or cater to their needs, you will have an opportunity to innovate. So it's really going from that perspective.
I think we have time for one or two more questions, maybe.
Hi.
Go ahead.
Thank you, Monica. You talked a little bit about the amount of folks on your accessibility team and some of the different focus areas. Just from an org modeling perspective, and it sounds like they all report up to you, is it a centralized team that sits within technology, or does it sit within a different area? And then my second question is, what challenges are you experiencing from an accessibility perspective within your organization that you're currently prioritizing and working on? Thank you.
Okay, so we sit in the technology space, and it's a good place to be sitting because that's where the money is. You know, when you have new technology, new digital programs, they have funding, so it's easier. If you're sitting in a compliance organization, that's always, you know, something. So I am where I am, and I'm happy in the technology space. Your other question was, what are the challenges that I'm seeing within the CVS? So, one of the biggest challenges is the legacy side of things. So we have a lot of legacy code. There's a lot of changes that are happening. So the net new stuff is more accessible. There's a lot of legacy stuff. There's a lot of dependency on systems in the IT side,
which are, you know, some of them are like even mainframe, you know, based. So it's basically trying to get our assets, you know, all to reach a certain level. They're different products that are at different places, but I think trying to get everybody, the legacy and the new, trying to bring them together is a problem area right now. Because it's costly for the legacy, but if a customer goes there and accesses the legacy part and it's not accessible versus the new side, it's still a problem, right? They're not going to care about the fact that the code behind it is legacy. So we make a lot of effort, but we are also very smart about, okay, this legacy feature is going to be deprecated in this PI. So if this is going to be deprecated in this quarter, as soon as product puts those features in into practice, we say, okay, we're not going to spend any more energy on it. I can keep going.
I guess we have one more question.
Excuse me. I know you talked a little bit about vendors, but what's your process for monitoring them to ensure that they, you know, don't later produce inaccessible code and you're caught off guard?
Sure. So, good question. Again, as you can imagine, the size of CVS, we've got hundreds and thousands of vendors. So again, I look at it from the perspective, I have to prioritize. If I've got vendors that are actually integrated into our front consumer-facing assets, we hold their feet to the fire, period. They get the same rigor as our assets do. If there's vendors that have already come into our organization prior to, you know, us having been made aware of them, then we look at what they're doing, what's the impact. We have conversations with them, and then we encourage them to go get their product audited and come up with a remediation plan. We understand remediating is not a simple task, but if a vendor is dedicated and, you know, engaging, they will come up with a remediation plan. We will respect it. Then if you think about professional services, those that, develop with you, because, you know, you hire people from some of those to augment your staff from time to time. We have quarterly meetings. So we had an initial kickoff with me and with leaders to basically stress upon the fact that CVS's accessibility policy is not differentiated for vendors. If you're developing, you're equally accountable. So the assets that they develop, we put it through the same rigor, but we also hold them accountable by coming up with their training plans. How are you going to ensure that the staff that is going to be coming into CVS is trained? And then we look at what their capabilities are for training. So, yeah, I don't give anybody a pass. So, it really, but, again, it's huge. But I have team members focused on vendors, but by educating the procurement team, that goes a long way. There's a supplier diversity team educating and partnering with them. So basically getting an army behind you to really support this work. So, yeah.
We want to thank everyone. We know we're the only ones standing between you and finding a happy hour. We've been speaking with Monica Goel, who's Executive Director of Digital Accessibility for CVS Health, on establishing a digital accessibility program at a large enterprise. And I'm going to put her on the spot. And your booth number on the floor? Does anybody here from CVS know? 614. Thank you.
It's the same as my
I told you I was going to put you on the spot on that. And the website, is there a website that talks about this at CVS Health?
We have, well, it's CVS.com, you can go to it, but we'll be launching our own CVS Health Accessibility.com very soon. So.
Excellent. Monica, thank you. It's been a pleasure interviewing you for this session. Thank you very much.
It's a pleasure to be here.
And let's give her a big hand. So CSUN ATC TV is now finished for the broadcast day. Thank you for joining us, and we'll be back tomorrow at 9:20.